What you just heard there is one of the most iconic sounds in Indian motorcycling history, and it's the sound of an old school Jawa firing up. Now, as you know, the all new Jawas have just been launched, and I'm off to Udaipur tomorrow to see what they're all about. But when a brand comes back with a legend like Jawa, there's a big responsibility to see if the new bike can capture the DNA of the original. Now, unfortunately, these bikes have come out well before my time, so I've come to a very special place in South Mumbai to meet a person who probably has a lot more perspective on the subject than I do.
This unassuming garage you see behind me is hidden away in a tiny lane in South Mumbai, and it has quite a fascinating story behind it. You see, this is one of the original Ideal Motors factory garages in Mumbai, but what's particularly special about this one is that it never really shut down, and it's been operational to this very day. Now, I've come here to meet Philip D'Souza, who's been working at the garage since 1991, and he's the man who keeps the place running. Now, Philip probably knows his Jawas better than many of us know ourselves, so I've come to have a chat with him about what made the original Jawas such icons, and what are the points that I should look out for in a modern embodiment of this classic Czech machine. Armed with this knowledge, I'm going to attempt to review the brand new Jawas by trying to find out how much these new motorcycles shape up in terms of the things that made the original bikes so special in the first place.
And now that I'm here at the first ride event, I'm really glad I had that chat with Philip, because one of the first things we discussed was just how similar the old and the new Jawas look. Aside from this different color scheme, you could easily be fooled into thinking that this is just a shinier looking version of the motorcycle I was admiring back in Mumbai.
And that's no exaggeration, because you could almost say that Classic Legends has built a copy of the original design, right from the teardrop headlamp to the chromed fuel tank and those iconic dual exhausts. But they couldn't get everything just the same, and the biggest visual differentiation comes in the engine. Because this is not a two-stroke like the original, Classic Legends couldn't really create the same unique round shape, but they've done a really commendable job by coming up with a clean and old-school design. But underneath that, this is a modern engine, and it has a sizable radiator that is neatly housed between the two frame down tubes at the front. Purists will also notice the difference in the wheel sizes, and where the old bike ran 16-inch wheels, the new one gets a larger 18-inch front and a 17-inch at the rear. The iconic side panels remain similar in design, but they have grown wider in this iteration. Despite all these differences, the Jawa remains instantly identifiable. But for those of you who wish the bike had a little more modern flavor, there's the Jawa 42. This bike essentially gets a conventional round headlamp, a shorter front fender, a wider and flatter handlebar, and an offset instrument cluster. The 42 also gets black color suspension covers, and there are some differences in the chrome detailing across the motorcycle. Aside from that and the more youthful color schemes, everything else remains the same on both machines. Overall, choosing between them is purely subjective, but I tend to lean towards the 42 because it looks a little more proportionate to me with its lower set headlamp. The horizontally set instrument cluster on the Jawa is also hard to read because the numbers at the base aren't clearly visible from the rider's point of view. But the 42 has no such issues. Ultimately though, both bikes are very pleasing to the eye.
The original Jawas were light motorcycles in their time, and Philip tells me that an important thing for a Jawa is that anybody should be able to ride it and enjoy doing so. Things bode well for the new one in that respect. The 765mm seat height is really low. In fact, it's a little too low for my taste, but I'm in the minority, so that's okay. The second thing is that this bike feels light and easy to manage. It's easy to pick up off the stand, and you can thank a 170kg curb weight for that, which is the same as a KTM RC390.
Next up, we have to address the sound. Now, obviously, it's impossible for a 4-stroke engine to match the music of a 2-stroke motor. But what made the old exhaust notes so popular was that it was a pleasing and unique sound to the ear. Does the new bike offer something similar? Well, let's start her up and find out.
That's a nice and fairly deep exhaust note, but more importantly, I think it's a sound you won't get tired of hearing.
Classic Legends say they've put a lot of work into getting the sound right, and to that extent, a clever design for the decibel killer allows it to be moved forward or back within the exhaust or removed entirely, and this helps you reduce or increase the volume of the exhaust. But it's not just the sound, and there's been a lot of work that's gone into the engine itself. It started life as a Mahindra Mojo motor, but aside from the basic architecture, much has changed. Among these changes are redesigned cams, new valves, and reworked exhaust ports. The single-minded focus here was on improving the low and mid-range performance, while also making sure that the bike could be BS6 emission norms compliant. To that effect, this engine does feel different to the Mojo, even though the sound is quite familiar. Throttle response is sweet and well-gauged in most scenarios, but there is the occasional hesitation when you accelerate from a partially open throttle at low revs. Bottom-end performance is smooth and there's a strong mid-range as well, thanks to peak torque arriving at just about 5,500 RPM. Refinement levels are decently contained at low revs, with only a mild tingle in the bar and pegs. But when you take the revs closer to the 7,500 RPM redline, there's a higher level of vibration and things do start to get a little harsh. Overall, it would have been nice if the engine was a little smoother. Happily though, performance is brisk, and a highway cruising speed of 100 to 110 km per hour is sustainable. On a long enough road, the bike will top out at about 135 km per hour. This is a lower top speed than the Mojo, and it's partly down to the new power delivery from the engine, but also because the final drive ratio has been tweaked in favor of rideability. As for the gearbox, the 6-speed unit is decently slick shifting, but I did encounter a couple of false neutrals along the way. Overall, the new Jawas pack a very flat and easily accessible torque delivery, but my memory suggests that the Mojo engine is a little bit smoother and faster. Of course, this is something we can only confirm when the Jawas come to us for a full test early next year.
It's a good thing the engine is fairly energetic, because back in the day, the Jawas were popular with those who wanted eager and fun performance from their motorcycles.
And fun these two are. As we mentioned earlier, both Jawas share the exact same chassis and suspension setup, which comprises a dual cradle frame, a telescopic fork, and dual shocks at the rear. On the road, the bike feels easy and quite nimble. What took me by surprise though was the suspension setup, because this bike is on the firm side, but without falling into the zone of harshness and discomfort. Bad roads are handled well and there's plenty of ground clearance. What does tend to make things uncomfortable though is that there's very thin padding on the seat and the hard metal below becomes apparent quite quickly. On long stretches of bad roads, this can get rather painful, so the seat is one area that needs addressing. Find some smooth winding roads and the Jawa pulls a treat with nimble and accurate handling that's quite a lot of fun. On these roads, we never encountered any cornering clearance issues, and the MRF Nilo grip tyres are competent partners in the pursuit of some fun when the mood arises. Stability also deserves a mention here, and the bike feels planted in most situations, but never gets heavy or lazy. Jawa enthusiasts will also be happy to know that this bike is quite game to take on a bit of a thrashing off-road as well. All of this holds true for both motorcycles, and they feel almost identical to ride, with the only difference being a slightly more commanding riding position on the 42 that has your arms stretched a little forward and spread just a bit wider. This friendly handling characteristic is well in line with the Jawa DNA, but when I urged Philip to tell me something that wasn't great on the old bike, he admitted that it had to be the weak brakes. The new bikes attempt to address this with a 280mm disc up front, single channel ABS, and a drum at the rear. Happily, there are no issues in the braking department anymore, and the bike stops well. The rear drum works decently well too, and is easy to modulate, but at this price, it's completely reasonable to be disappointed by the lack of a rear disc brake.
And speaking of the price, neither of these bikes comes very cheap, but they don't offer much in the way of frills or features.
The Jawas really do aim to offer a pure and simple riding experience, and that's fine, but there are some things that could have been better. The meters, for example, only show speed, fuel, and odo information, and I'd like to have had at least a trip meter. Further still, there's no side stand down indicator or engine cutoff. Finish levels are quite good, especially around the clean and uncluttered engine. But we did find a few areas where quality and attention to detail could be higher. Classic Legends assures us that the bikes we've ridden are still pre-production models, and these finishing issues should be addressed in the final production motorcycles, which will be out early next year. So we'll give them the benefit of the doubt for now. Overall though, the new Jawas are a great first effort for a brand new company, and most of the issues we found are relatively minor and they can be ironed out with time and process control. However, I do think the price is a little on the high side, but that doesn't seem to be having any effect on the massive interest that these bikes have generated.
Most of all though, I must say the Classic Legends has done a good job of keeping within the Jawa brand DNA. And when Philip finally gets to ride one of these new bikes, I'm almost certain he'll get off with a smile on his face.